Happy Sunday, everyone. Happy Sunday. Happy Sunday. What's up, T-Whip? I am waiting for my co-host to come up. What's up, Claudean? I can't hear you.
No?
Oh, I can hear you now. I can hear you now. You're good. Okay. Good afternoon. Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
You look nice, man.
I appreciate that. Thank you so much.
All right, let me see if it's me that needs to be turned up or if it's you. Let me see. Go ahead. Now talk.
Hi.
All right, I can hear you. Can everybody hear?
Can you hear me still or no?
It sounds a little, just a tad bit muffled.
Hold on. Ricky! Ricky! I'm gonna get my headphones, but my friend, he is using it.
No. You're good. You're good.
All right, so I have to hold the phone.
Okay.
I gotta hold it.
Yeah. All right. Your mic ain't working?
Sort of.
Okay, cool. You're fine. You sound good. You're good. All right, before we start, okay, let's go ahead and get these likes on up, please. Let's get them up to about, you're live on your side, so if you can, on Claudine's side, go ahead and get the likes up for her so we could get more engagement, more people on. On this side, if we can, get the likes up just a tad bit more. Let's get it up to about 500. And then we're going to start the topic. Tonight we're talking about co-parenting. Now, this is my first time meeting Claudean. We've talked a few times on live. And yeah, so we've built not so much of a bond, but something like a long distance TikTok friendship, I guess you could say, right? All right, we got Shapira in here. How many people you got over there?
193.
Huh?
It says 193.
There you go. Look at you.
Yeah.
This is your first live, isn't it?
This is. I've had two lives before, but it was just one of those. I was at the New York City Winery, and I was just recording.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it, but like an actual live like this, this is my first one.
Okay, that's what's up. All right, so we are going to talk about co-parenting. Now, thank you, Shapira, for getting the likes up. I appreciate you, sweetheart. Everybody that's on Claudine's side, we appreciate y'all for being here tonight with us. You could have been anywhere else, but you are here with us, so we greatly appreciate that. What's up, Riley? So, like I said, the topic for tonight is co-parenting. I'm a father. I have, you know, of course, my wife. We have three kids together, and I have two children's moms as well, besides her. So, co-parenting, I'm not a pro at it, but I have to do it. What about you, Claudean? Actually, you know what? Introduce yourself so everybody can see this pretty face.
And I am boys. One baby daddy is one. And again, as you stated, I am not a pro at this co-parenting thing, but, you know, just navigating through it, you know, as we could as parents.
Good, good, good. All right. Let's see here. So the first question is, what is co-parenting? What's your take on that, Claudine?
Two parents who are no longer together.
Mm-hmm.
Coming together for the sake of their children.
Mm-hmm.
Having patience, being neutral, having an understanding, agreeing as best as they can for the sake of their children.
That sounds pretty good. I would say, you know, just like you, two people that are mending ways or parting ways, collectively coming together to do, to bring up a healthy relationship between, you know, them, both of them, the parents, the kid, for the betterment of that child. So that's what I would say it is. Let me see here. Do you think anyone or everyone in this predicament can have a healthy co-parenting relationship?
And you have to ask yourself, are you going to have the patience to deal with this person or whatever they have going on in their household or whatever in life to come together for the sake of your kid? You have to have the patience to deal with each other.
Hey, Claudine, hold on 1 second, because they're saying that they can't hear you on this side. You sound just a tad bit muffled.
I don't know why. Can you hear me now, or?
Yeah, we can hear you now. So the way that you're holding your phone, are you holding it to where it's covering up the mic? Because if it's covering up the mic or whatever, then they won't be able to hear it. I think that's probably it.
I'm not covering the mic anymore, so.
Okay.
Okay, yeah.
All right, you sound good. Right, sounds better.
Okay, cool. Just compromising and coming together for the sake of your kids, are you willing to do that? Are you willing to put your ego to the side to hear each other out for the sake of your children? Because it's always an ego thing, and sometimes it never works out.
Do you think it's always an ego thing?
Most of the time, yeah.
Okay, and why is that?
Well, I'm right. No, I'm right. No, I'm right. It's an ego thing. It's
So you're saying an ego thing on both sides. Okay.
It's always one parent that wants to one up the other parent. Sometimes.
I can see that. I'm not gonna put myself out there, but I could be a little guilty of that as well, trying to one up, right? Which is. But it's not healthy. So do I think that everyone in this predicament can have a healthy co-parenting relationship? I believe if people try hard enough, they can. Do I think 100% everyone can? No, it's people just have their differences. And with those differences comes negativity, fights, arguments, and they just can't get together. The reason why they got divorced, right, or separated. So with counseling, with help, guidance, I think you can get there. But it's a work in progress. Definitely a work in progress. I have two children, three. But two outside of my wife, and our relationships weren't always the best, you know? And then also it would go back and forth as far as the relationship as well. As far as 1 week we're good, or I think we're good, right? And then next thing you know, we're not good. And it also comes to the point of, like, has that person really let go? So that's a big contributing factor of having a healthy co-parenting relationship is, can we get out of that space as far as like, I love you this much, I can't be without you, whatever, blah, blah, blah. I want to mess up your relationships, your new relationships and stuff like that, and just solely think on the children, then I think, but that's hard. It's easier said than done. So, yeah, that's just my take on it.
I agree wholeheartedly. It's sometimes in those situations, it's one of those, if I can't have you, nobody else can. But I'm not going to express that, or I'm not going to share that. So yeah, I might do something to sabotage. If you're in a relationship, I might do something to sabotage it. Or I'm not going to compromise, or I'm not going to pick Junior up from daycare or school, or I'm not going to, you know, and sometimes it does affect the child.
I think it affects the child all the time. You feel what I'm saying? The way that I look at it is, if, especially if my child is with their mom, majority of the time, right? She is the custodial parent. I'm the non-custodial. That's how they put it in law terms, right? So my daughters are with their moms majority of the time, right? So if their mom isn't good, then they're not good. If they see us arguing back and forth with each other, then the mom is not good. They're not good. So I had to get out that mind frame of, as far as like, yo, you gotta tighten up. But, and that's just me taking accountability for my actions. But it wasn't always my fault. What's up, Fluffy? So yeah, that's what I had to say on that. I would like to just take a break real quick. A quick second, and just say what's up to my people over here. I see y'all. I appreciate y'all stopping by. Much love. And Claudine, go ahead, take it away with your people.
Hey people, the live, all that. Appreciate
yeah.
You for the people that's in here now. Appreciate y'all for the live. Thank you.
Yep, you'll see more of us. Let me see here. So different households. How does that play out?
So I may do things one way, or I may have my routine here at the other parent's house. They may have their routine over there. Sometime it clashes, and that's where the arguments might start. Well, in the morning and at night, he's supposed to brush his teeth, but he only brushed it at night and not in the morning. What's up with that? And vice versa. Well, you're supposed to bring the clothes, and I'm, you know, it's literally a plethora of things. I have my routine here. Kids are supposed to be in bed at 8. When you're at father's house, okay, they go to bed at 10, 11, 12, then they can't get up for school. So when they come here, they're tired, they don't want to get up. So it's like, that's where the communication factor comes in. You have to compromise as well, as far as how your routine is gonna go for the sake of the kids. It's not an ego thing, it's for the kids' sake.
Mm-hmm.
It's routine based.
Yeah. I think that's where the, like you said, the communication needs to come into play. But if you're not on good terms, then there's no good communication. This is, ooh, y'all gonna hear some stories from me. I can't hear you again.
And you kind of just got to wing it from there. As far
yeah.
As, if they're going to bed and waking up early, I mean, they're going to bed late and they can't wake up early, it's something that you're going to kind of have to be patient with as far as the kids.
So do you think that they should abide by the rules of, well, of course they need to abide by the rules of the whichever house they're in, right? But if they're with you majority of the time, your kids, right? If they're with you majority of the time, do you think that some of those rules that you have as far as like bedtime and when they do things should apply to at the father's house as well?
Well, it would be nice to keep the routine going, but at the same time, I can't say what goes over there. Mm-hmm. You know, only certain things I will say, like I don't want them to be around certain activities or certain things that you may do that should not involve kids.
Yeah.
You know, anything I would say, but I can't tell you what to do as far as what goes on in your household. But it would be nice to keep the routine going for the sake of both of us, though.
Yeah, the different household thing, it's because, like, for instance, for like with my daughter, right, she lives with her mom or whatever. And as far as like the bedtime thing, she goes to bed pretty early, but then she comes over here and I just let her I let her have at it. You feel what I'm saying? As long as I know that you can get up at a decent time or whatever. And plus, when she does come over here, it's not like it's really during the school week, it's during the weekends, you feel me? So I'll allow them to stay up, you know, pretty late, and but I know my kids know how to, you know, they're responsible, whatever, get up on time or whatever and do what they got to do, get up, brush your teeth and all that good stuff. So the what is instilled in them is not really being, as far as with her mom, it's not being taken away from when she comes here. You feel what I'm saying? It's not being taken away when she comes here. And we have that kind of, I guess, that relationship where we talk to each other on those type of things, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
There's always one that's the strict parent, like the strict parent or the parent that's on top of things, and then there's the fun parent.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always the parent that the kids are not around every single day is the fun parent, and the parent that they're around all the time is the strict parent.
Yeah.
So, you know, when your daughter comes over and you let her rock, then, you know, she's having fun versus...
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's always that dynamic with the kids. So I can't wait to go to daddy's house. I can't wait to go to mommy's house. And we do this, you know? Yeah.
Yeah, I think I'm like 50-50, though. Like, I'm strict, but I am, like, fun. I'm like the fun dad. I like to... You know, I'm a big kid at heart, really. You feel what I'm saying? So... I just love being around the kids and just enjoying what they do and seeing them do what they do. You feel me? So, but when I have to lay the law down, then I have to lay the law down as well. So, yeah. Let me see here. What about parenting styles?
Well, that's where we come in with the separate households as well. Again, the strict parent, the fun parent. The strict parent, they have a routine, or you can't do this, you can't eat this. And then the fun parent, eat whatever you want, I don't care, just go eat it, go ahead, watch TV, do what you want. So it's definitely okay. Like in my situation, their dad is more strict. I'm strict, but I'm 50-50 as well.
Mm-hmm.
Don't cross me, don't do this, but we can do this, but I need you to chill out and I need you to behave. And I became the parent where my kids, they come to me and talk to me about anything. I want them to be comfortable. I want them to express themselves and let
of
me
course.
Know what I mean? And build that level of trust.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not even, you know, but, you know, sometimes they can't go to no one else and talk to them about certain things. But I let them know, like, listen, I don't want you going to find out nothing from nobody else. I don't want you going out there talking to nobody else. I need you to sit with me and let's have a conversation. What's going on? What's on your mind? Like, talk to me.
Yeah.
My kids let it all out. And even my oldest son, you know, I talked to him about the birds and the bees.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was a very uncomfortable conversation. Very uncomfortable. And that was a conversation I felt like their dad should have had.
I was going to ask you that.
Right. And I don't know. I guess he felt uncomfortable with bringing it up. So
who, the father or your son?
Right, the father. And I felt like he was uncomfortable with bringing that up. So what I did was, to break the ice, I invested in these books. And they were books about boys and hitting puberty and development. And it literally... In color form, just everything that a teenage boys go through, pimple, hair, and wet dreams. Like, it literally talks about everything. So to break the ice, I'm like, here you go. Sit with him. Go through these things with him.
Mm-hmm.
And he never did. And I said, all right, well, give me the books back. I'll go through it with him. And I sat with him, and It was uncomfortable, but I spoke to him. We talked it out. Mm-hmm. Talked to him about getting his heart broken and how, you know, your first heartbreak and how it's gonna suck, and sat with him and literally laid everything out.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I don't think he has that, you know, with the other parent. I don't ask though. I don't, because I want that to be between them.
Mm-hmm. Just a little bit of advice as far as like the birds and the bees and asking the other parent if they're talking to him. I think that you should. That's just my opinion. I think that you should, due to the fact that it could save your son from a lot of shit. You feel what I'm saying? Like pregnancy is a big thing. You feel what I'm saying? So, and that's part of the birds and the bees. That's it. You feel what I'm saying? But as also, like, my question wouldn't be directed towards you, but more so towards your child's father, is why is he feeling uncomfortable to have these conversations with his son, knowing what we have out here these days? You feel what I'm saying?
Well, and in his defense, I will say this. My parents never taught me about the birds and the bees. I had to go find out from someone else, and he was the same way. And I guess he felt uncomfortable, and I guess he felt like he didn't want to. I'm just assuming, because I did ask, hey, can you sit with him? This is the time. I think my son was like 12 at the time, I think. And I said, you know, this is the time where he's gonna start having feelings and certain things, and we just want to prepare him for at least that. And he said, all right, I'll do it. And then I asked, and he just never did it. And I'm like, all right, well, let me get run these books. Give me back my books, and I'll sit with our son. And I told him about all of that. And I even said, you know, if you feel that, you know, you want to take it that stuff with a young girl, I prefer you not to. But if you are... let me know. You know, I want to prepare you for that. And he said, okay. And he opens up to me, and we talk about it, and he tells me about his little girlfriends and what he has done. So we have that line of communication.
And that's good to have, as far as like that trust level with that your son has towards with you. Because a lot of parents these days, parenting has no rule book to it. So at the end of the day, it's like, we're winging this motherfucker at the end of the day. You feel what I'm saying? We're winging it as we go. And each child is different. So
I feel like a parenting handbook.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like a shot glass and a shot next to it. Like,
exactly.
Parenting is not easy.
Mm-hmm. It really isn't. And just learn as we go, I guess, right? But as far as like that birds and what's that?
Trial and error,
that's all it is. And as far as like the birds and the bees or whatever, I think that within different demographics, right? So I can see my 14-year-old. I can see his body, how it's forming, how he's getting bigger. You know what I mean? He's getting a little stash or whatnot, right? But he's 14 years old. He just started that, you know. So I'm just like, I'm keeping an eye on him to see when I want to have that birds and the bees talk with him. It's gonna be soon, right? But also like the kids over here, they're not effing. You know what I mean, like that. But in different demographics, inner city public schools and stuff like that, more low income areas and stuff like that, yes, they're more apt to be able to have to do that. You feel what I'm saying? I believe that. You know what I mean? But I know, I don't think my son is doing that right now.
Because you can assume that none of them kids are doing that. These kids are, especially if they have cell phones and especially if they're in high school, these kids are different. So you really need to definitely watch or look through their phones and yeah.
Oh, trust me. I have this thing where I just bust into my son's room unexpectedly. What the fuck you doing, bro? You jacking off? But nah, I feel like if he would come and talk to me, and a lot of parents don't have that where their kids would come and talk to them. And I was having a conversation on another live the other day as far as like, would you consider your child a friend or like you're like a 100% parent without any type of like, you know, friend activity. I guess that's how you would put it. So do you see yourself as a parent slash friend or like a, you know what I mean? I guess I want to explain it the correct way, but I see my kids as my kids. They know what lines to cross and what lines not to cross, but I also see those as my little partners. You feel what I'm saying? Like I walk up to my 4-year-old, what's up, man? Yo, you know what I mean? I go to my 2-year-old, what's up? What's up? What's up, bro? You know what I mean? I want them to feel that comfortability with me that they can come to me about anything and everything because this world is just getting worse and worse by the day.
It is.
Yeah.
And you want to keep them close, and you want them to know, like, listen, I trust you. You can trust me. Like, the level of trust that you have for your kids is definitely very important.
All right, so we kind of veered off just a little bit with that one, but it's fine. It's good. So we have keeping the other parent up to date. What you think?
The other so my take on that, keeping them up to date, appointment, maybe I can't make it to the doctor's appointment, dentist appointment, or whatever have you made. Hey, can you make it the appointment? I set it for a month in advance. Can you request that day off, and can you take them? Or hey, little Jody has baseball or basketball practice, and he really wants you there. Can you be there? So keeping them, up to, proms and dances, your little first time things that these activities that the kids engage in that you want to, have a, remember, oh my God, I was there for this moment and that moment. So you want to keep them up to date on things like that. And you don't want to take that away from the other parent because, that's kind of mean. Like, keep them up to date. It's up to them if they want to make it or do these things or not, but at least inform them that this going
So we have somebody, right? Major Flips. I'm always inside of Major Flips, his lives. My man is a he's a funny dude, man, but he be having some real deep conversations in his lives. What I will say about this right here, Major Flip, is that we're just doing like a host co-host type deal right now, right? I see your comment in there and I see that you're requesting to come up, but after we finish with the topic as far as like what we're talking about just between me and her right now, since we're doing like a host co-host type deal, then we're gonna allow people to come up. So if you want to come back, bro, or just stay in here, listen, and we'll add you in as soon as possible. But he said co-parenting is BS. Staying married is the goal. I can't knock you for that. That is totally true. But shit happens, bro. And you know it. Huh?
Right.
Shit
Yeah, and
happens. You know? Marriage is the goal and staying married is the goal.
yeah,
But that is
especially.
why we have a high percentage of divorce. And that is why. And this is gonna veer off. See, Major Flip, you're about to make me veer off on this because people just don't know how to be honest. They don't know how to be honest. And this is just me being totally transparent and totally taking accountability. It be the men. They don't know how to take responsibility and be honest and upfront with the person that they are with. You feel what I'm saying? And majority of the time, if you look up statistically, it is due to infidelity, is due to income or monetary. And what is it? Is it sex? I think possibly. I think those are the top three.
Infidelity.
Mm-hmm. But I think infidelity is like number two or three. I think it's money that's number one.
No, no, it'd be the women too.
Yeah, it does be the women. Trust me. I know that.
Maury has how many seasons? So it be the women too.
Yeah, I'm not going to throw it just solely on the men, but we have to also take accountability as well, right? That is why a lot of people get divorced is because of infidelity. And then who be the people that be doing the infidelity? The men.
Both sexes. No.
I'm gonna stick with the men. I just yes, men and women cheat. Yes, mm-hmm. They both cheat, but it's right. Usually the men that step out first, and that is just in my opinion. You feel what I'm saying? BX Hello said 90% of the time. I don't know about all of that now. Real men don't cheat. I just fuck with you. But he also said co-parenting confuses the baby. But that's where I go back and say that is just you cannot help what happens. You feel what I'm saying? You want me to be stuck with this person for the rest of my life and be miserable? Well, now you're fucking with my peace. You feel what I'm saying? Now if I'm miserable 24/7, that's my peace. So why be with a person and just be miserable? That's my take.
Well, this is the thing. So before you get married and before you have kids and when you're with someone, you're literally with them, and then you see them in all four seasons. You see how they are. You see how in every aspect, or mostly every aspect of their life throughout these seasons, you see how they are. Now, when you get married, that's a new title. You're going to have to see how this person is in four seasons of being a husband or being a wife. Mm-hmm. Now, you put a kid in this.
Mm-hmm. You got that off of T.D. Jakes, didn't you?
Huh?
That four seasons, you got that off of T.D. Jakes, didn't you?
I'd get that off of T.D. Jakes. For
oh, that...
I will send me the link and I'll check it out.
Okay.
You really got to see somebody in their four seasons. And now I'm a wife, I'm a wife and now I'm a mom, or vice versa. Now I was a man and husband and now I'm a father. Now these are different seasons as well. Now the motherhood and the fatherhood, are we able to compromise? Are we able to communicate? You know, the first stages of, you know, the newborn stages when the baby is born. Who's going to get up? Baby's going to be up all night. Who's going to get up? And we both love sleeping. Then the mother might take on that role majority of the nights, and she's miserable because she's looking at her husband getting sleep, or it can be vice versa. Now y'all both miserable because you're tired. This and now it's all about the baby, and it's not about husband and wife anymore. Yet we're not a married couple, we're just parents.
It definitely falls on compromising. But let's be real. If that woman is having a baby, who do you think is really getting up in the middle of the night? The woman. Especially if you breastfeed. And then I know a lot of people that want to play this gender role. And we're going off topic, but it's fine. It is cool. Shit happens like this sometimes. I was just talking to a friend the other day, and I was just telling him, I was like, man, you a lucky motherfucker because you get to get in this damn truck early in the morning, right? And get your ass down to Savannah and back. And he was like, man, yeah. I was like, man, you got big kids though. I didn't know he had a 4-year-old. I said, he said, yeah, I got a 4-year-old. I said, I do too. That's what's up. I said, but I stay at home. And I help my wife get the kids together, take them to school and stuff like that. And then I get my ass in that truck, take my ass down to Savannah, come back, go and pick up my kids as well. He said, nah, that's for the woman to do. What? I said, all right, bro, you got it. That's that gender role shit. You feel what I'm saying? Like,
and these conversations are important to have pre-marriage and pre-children.
Mm-hmm.
So you know what the hell you're getting yourself into. Because yeah. Maybe he thought that way before he got married and before he had kids. Mm-hmm. Now, if it was that's a woman's job. Okay. I wish you the best in life, and mm-hmm. I hope that you find what you're looking for. I'm not it.
Mm-hmm.
And you go your way and I go mine.
Yeah.
Because I wasn't the only one that made this baby. You know what I mean? It should definitely be, listen, we're a team. So let's raise this kid.
Yeah.
It's a woman. Nah, no.
Exactly. You both played the part to make this child. So how about we work collectively together to make things fucking work? Okay. So, you wash the kids. I'll put the clothes on them. You get up this night with this baby. I get up this night with this baby. You know what I mean? That is why I see, like, as far as I got to be able to, I have to be that man to see what my wife, her body language, right? And when I see her body language, and like I said before, if she's not okay, the kids are not okay. So that's why I've adopted this. Okay, now you go out for the weekend. You stay out for the weekend. And I'll be here with the kids. You feel what I'm saying? So yeah, I don't know. But yeah, a lot of people have that gender role mentality. And that, you know, man is supposed to do this, woman's supposed to do that, and that's the stamp. No, it's not. Like I tell everybody, my wife and I, we play to the beat of our, we walk to the beat of our own drum. Bottom line, I don't have to imitate anybody, what they do or how they do it, because what they do and how they do it is generally not going to work in my household. So we got to curate my household to fit the way that we want it to fit. And that's just bottom line. Who is Tokyo Tony? You know who Tokyo Tony is?
Of course I know who Tokyo Tony is.
BX Hello says she must be from, what is that? Brooklyn? BX? Brooklyn?
Me?
No, just BX. Oh. What is BX is Brooklyn, right? Bronx. No, Bronx.
K is Brooklyn.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's the Bronx. My bad. Oh. Yeah, but who? I'm just trying to figure out who the hell is Tokyo Tony. She said that was the first. That's the sound came to my head. Let me see here. Addressing the children's emotional needs, which while co-parenting.
So going back to the ego thing and, I'm trying to get it out. So when I say, Let me start over. So the kids' emotional and mental needs, sometimes when you guys are not together, it does affect them. And if, you know, you might not think it's going to affect them. If you come together, it affects them. Because once you guys split and you go your separate ways, then they're going to kind of start acting out. And it's going to show in their schoolwork. It's going to show in their behavior that they're acting out because mommy and daddy aren't together. And that usually is what happens. So sometimes this is how they show them acting out. When my parents split up, they were married and there's four of us and I'm the third one. And when my parents split up, I fell into depression because my dad and I were literally like this. We still are, but my dad and I are like this. So when they split up and my dad moved to Massachusetts and we remained in New York and eventually we moved to Florida, that affected me a lot. And I couldn't focus in school. I had developed an addiction to food. I coped with food a lot. So that's just, you know, that's just a personal experience for me. And my siblings and I, we coped with it, you know, in different ways. Whenever we would come together, holidays and weekends or whatever have you may, it was fun and it felt great. And then it was time to go. And there's a whole bunch of, I would literally bawl my eyes out because, like I said, my dad and I were, you know, we're like this. Bawl my eyes out and go back to school the next day. I'd just be like, I put my head on my desk, cry, and I just wouldn't be happy. I just wasn't happy. And that it affected me a lot. And now that my kids, you know, their dad and I aren't together, but it affects them because they want mommy and daddy to be together. My older son has mentioned that a few times in the past. Well, I want mommy and daddy to be together. And no matter what I said to my son, like, listen, we'll come together. We're both in your life. We'll come together. We'll go to therapy. We'll do this. We'll do that. Like, but we can't be together. You know, we can't do that. And, you know, their dad remarried and has more children. And I'm like, yo, like, it's okay. Like, we're still coming together for the sake of you and your brother, you know? But it does affect them mentally and emotionally.
And that's why I said there needs to be a part two to this, because there's so much more to this. And I was just looking up certain things, and one thing that popped up was like both parents moving in and cohabitating with each other. But that's for another top. That's for another day. That's for another day. I'm gonna do,
Another
another day.
Yeah.
So this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna give it a minute. Y'all tap that screen on both sides, please. If you're liking the topic for tonight, let's go ahead and run these likes up. Let's get some more people up in here. We're gonna be here for not too much longer, but we're gonna try to take our time on this, but we won't be here for too much longer. So if y'all
What I
can,
wanted.
for the next minute.
Well, what I want to do, I wanted to get out of my live and join you on your live,
Okay.
and then we can do like the questions and all that.
Yes, ma'am, that'd be fine with me. You want to drop down?
I'm gonna drop down. All
Okay.
right.
All right. So while she's doing that, y'all go ahead and run those likes up for me real quick, and she'll be right back. You there, Claudine? You there? Nah, I still can't hear you.
Hear
There
me.
we go. There we go. I don't know what you're doing with your phone, bro. I mean, damn. Your phone's, man, you must got an Android or something.
I don't ever in your life. I got the 15, okay? Don't ever. I need headphones. My son got my headphones.
Oh, for real?
Yes, he has my headphones. That's what I need, my headphones.
Okay. Like I said, for the next minute, y'all just go ahead and if y'all like this content right now, just go ahead and tap that screen. Get us up to about 35, and then we'll continue. Claudine, if you can, just put pound FYP on that. Pound FYP. Try to get a couple more people, and then we're gonna let some people get in the box, and we could all discuss this.
Where
Hey,
is that?
you did great for your first live. I want you to know that.
Thank
Yeah,
you.
you did. You did.
Can I be real with you?
What's up?
I needed something to like loosen me up a little bit.
There you
So,
go. Is that Angry Orchard? The apple?
yes, the
My.
green apple. Yes.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
That's something. So, yeah.
I was gonna
Where is
ask you what you I was gonna ask you what you're gonna be drinking on. Whenever my wife and I do the podcast or whatever, we she has her wine, and she introduces herself and says what wine she's drinking, and then I usually just yeah, just I don't know, just drink whatever. Heavy Arms. Heavy Arm 03, what's good, bro? Let's go ahead and run these likes up real quick. Just a couple more seconds, y'all, and we're gonna continue on. And if you wanna If you want to join, go ahead and request, and we'll get you up. I need you know what? I'm gonna get Major Flips back. Hold on, no, I'm not. Major Flips, like he like talking over people. So,
no. You know what? No, it's fine. Get him.
No, not right now. Not right.
Okay.
He's gonna give people a run for their money, right? But when you try to get him to be like, yo, calm down a little bit, just let the person talk and get their thing, he's gonna continue talking. But I love him. I love his lives, man. But yeah, I appreciate y'all. We at 3.5 right now. So let me see here. Avoiding arguments in front of the children.
That's tough. That is very, very hard. Sometimes, you know, co-parenting is not perfect.
Mm-hmm.
You bump heads a lot, a whole lot. Sometimes the parent is going to do something that the other parent doesn't like, vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
Then verbal jabs, sometimes it might end up physical. Sometimes the other parent is dating and the other parent doesn't like it. Vice versa, verbal jabs and arguments come about, and I've been through that. I've been through it, and it wasn't cool. It was stressful. Eventually, him and I got it together for the sake of our kids. Like, listen, strictly we talk about the children and the children only.
Mm-hmm.
What I got going on ain't got nothing to do with you. Everything to do with me and nothing to do with you, vice versa. And we said, okay. And it's been working.
I've never been the type. Now, I've been in relationships as far as, of course, you're going to have those disagreements, those arguments, but I've always been the type that I don't want the kids to see it, right? Because at the end of the day, it's hard to avoid any arguments. So let's go take this out. Let's take this conversation outside in the car. Right. That's just me. Let's do that. If it gets to a heated point, you know, let's take it outside into the car. If we could talk it out, we could do that in a bedroom or anywhere. Right. But,
ain't no bedroom if you're co-parenting.
Mm-mm. Well, as far... All right, so I was talking, that was me and my wife. But as okay, far as like co, as far as co-parenting, yeah, bedrooms, no. But we could go out, step outside, right, and we could do that. Now, as far as like physical, don't put your hands on me, because I'm not gonna put my hands on you, right? I just never believed in that. If I feel like it's gonna get to that point, I'm out. I'm done. Right. Right. We could have this conversation another day. Cool off. But putting your hands on me, that's a no-no. Because me personally, I know how I am. And men got to know their strengths as well. You feel what I'm saying? So yeah, that enough said on that. But as far as like having a conversation, yeah, we need to have this conversation. Just don't do the arguing in front of the kids, if all possible.
Sometimes, like I said before, it's an ego thing. All right, I have an example, and you know, this kind of it definitely, I felt some type of way. It was a video, and I believe the dad was recording. And the dad went and got his son a haircut. And the mother didn't like that. And I think she probably came and got the kids early when it was his time. And I can't believe you would cut my son's hair. How dare you? And I'm like, he's the dad, right? So they're arguing back and forth. No, he's like, yo, it's my weekend. Like, what do you, and she's getting in his face. No, I didn't tell you to cut my son's hair. And scenario, that's one scenario. Another scenario, and this went viral, where the dad took his daughter to get her hair braided and the mother cut the girl's hair. I don't know if you remember that. It came out like a couple of years ago, and out of spite, and she's cussing the dad out, she cuts the daughter's hair. So like I always said, it's an ego thing. It's always an ego thing.
And bitter.
And bitter.
That sounds like a bitter baby mama.
And there is plenty of those. There's bitter baby daddies too, but they're
I used to my child's mom used to be that way. She did not. When I first started dating my wife now, she's like, don't my daughter has like some pretty long hair down to her shoulders, past her shoulders. Don't you let her touch my daughter's hair. I'm like, come on, bro. So I was to avoid the arguments, the fights and shit like that, I just took her to go get her hair done from a professional, which be, it's the same fucking thing. You feel what I'm saying? Someone else is touching her head, you know? So, but to avoid all of that, you know, just, you know, talk it out, I guess, compromise. But now they're on a better term. We're older now, and we're not on that type of time anymore. So yeah, I'm glad about that. So, ooh, dating other people.
Again, now let's be real. When you have kids together and you guys eventually break up, and please, and sometimes, all right, well, I don't want to be with you anymore. Let's go our separate ways. And sometimes I give people this advice. I have a friend who, he's going through some co-parenting issues. The only thing I'm gonna say is when the moment they broke up and he's like, "Yeah, I'm just ready to get this over with. I want to break up. I want to get a divorce," and so forth. I mentioned, I said, "All right, yeah, that's cool. Can you handle seeing her with another woman and the other guy being with your children? Can you handle that?" You're in your feelings now and you want to get it done and over with, but I'm pretty sure once you see her with somebody else, you're gonna feel some type of way. But I'm good, I'm good. She started dating someone else and he broke down. Broke down. And I said, "Cry. You're human. It's okay. It's all right." Because you guys were so used to being together and you have kids. She's not just your ex-girlfriend. No, she's now your ex-wife, but still the mother of your kids. So of course it's, and you're human, it's okay. So it's emotional for the other parent. It'll always be emotional, but you can get to the level of maturity eventually.
Eventually, it takes some time.
It does take time. And to be completely honest, when kind of the similar situation, and that's why I brought it up to my friend, can you handle that? My kid's father and I broke up, and we just vowed never to get back together. But he found someone. I was like, all right, cool. And then he told me that she got pregnant, and I'm not gonna lie to you, it broke my heart because I was always the only one. It was just always us, our kids, even though we weren't gonna be together. But it like I broke down in tears, and I literally had to pray to God, like, God, please help me get through this. Why am I crying? And I'm like, yo, I'm human. I'm gonna get over it. And eventually I got over it. Better her than me. They got married. I'm happy for them. You know what I mean? And that's their story. And I totally happy for them.
This is a touchy one right here for me, as far as like the dating other people. Like, I was never the jealous type, as far as like if my child's mother wanted to move on, it was the other way around. Now, when it came to me, I feel like, and I have a good judgment of people as far as like who I am, courting, dating, thinking about introducing to my children, right? But I knew for a fact how this other person was, dating my child's mother, because I knew him from, I told you I went to Job Corps, so I knew him from Job Corps. So I already knew who he was as a person. You feel what I'm saying? So yeah, I wasn't feeling it. You know what I mean? And damn it, I was right. I mean, altercations between them two. So I had to step in a lot when it came to, my child. Don't you y'all could do what the fuck y'all want to do, right? Just don't do it in front of my child. Once I see my child is in this danger, do I want you to be with this person? No, but I cannot tell you who to be with and who not to be with. But as soon as I see my child, her spirit's going down, her mental is shifting, and then that's when Daddy Rich is gonna have to step in. You feel what I'm saying? James, you went to Job Corps also? Which one did you go to? I went to the one in Albany, Georgia. That's another story too. I dropped out of high school my last 2 weeks of school. And yeah, ended up going having to go to Job Corps. And then I finished it up. I got my diploma, so yeah. So yeah, I have a story behind me as well. Upstate New York. That's what's up. That's what's up. I don't know if I should have went to the one in Albany, Georgia. It was bad, but I made it through. I was there for like a matter of like 4 to 6 months or whatever, and then I was off to the military. But that's pretty much it for the questions, Claudine. Do you have anything you want to say? Anybody want to join? Let me see here. I was trying to find Major Flip, but I think I sent him one.
Let him come up and yeah.
What'd you say?
I say, yeah, let him come up and give and yeah.
Yeah, I was trying to find him. I think he probably logged off. I'm gonna send it to him again. But yeah, what you got planned for the rest of the day or night?
The rest of the night, I don't have anything planned. Probably put some content out on TikTok and chill.
That's what's up. I think you have I think that you have the ability to do good on these lives and stuff like that, your own lives, and move further up in the TikTok world. You feel me?
Do it.
I think you should start doing it more often.
Think you're right. I think you're right. I do want to add something on though, and I've seen it today, and I meant to send it. I meant to just forward it to you, and I never got the chance to. And this definitely has something to do with our topic tonight. I don't know if you've seen, but I can't even, Darius McCrary or Eddie Winslow from Family Matters. He's going through. He's actually locked up for owing child support. And I kind of wanted to, bonus, kind of like talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, that's my forte right there, 'cause I'm on child support for two.
I thought it was very unfortunate. I don't know the parenting situation. I can't comment because I don't know, but I feel like if the parent if he's hopefully he's active in the child's life. I don't know, like I said. But I feel like a lot of times when I say, and I'm speaking on, behalf of some women who have motives, like when they date a celebrity, then it's just like ka-ching. Now we haven't seen Eddie Winslow do much lately. And I don't know what his residual checks is looking like from Family Matters. He made a couple of appearances on other shows and a couple of movies and things like that. But we don't know what this man's financial status is looking like. So I feel like it's messed up for women to even do such a thing.
So here's my take on this. If you are active in your child's life, if you're active in your child's life and you are doing the responsible things that you're supposed to do which includes monetary, because your child needs, they're going to need things, right? Unless that parent, the custodial parent, is making a lump sum of a good amount of money yearly, then that they could just take it on by for themselves or whatever, right? If he's doing what he needs to do, then don't put him on child support. But if he's not doing what he's supposed to do, then put him on child support. We had this conversation the other day as well, on here, and it wasn't on here, it was on someone else's. But man, that's a tough one. As far as like, if the person is doing what they're supposed to do, don't put them on, because you never know what might happen. Like, we just went through a whole pandemic, right? People lost their jobs, but they're still expected to pay that money, right? They're still expected to pay that money. So how can I pay for something when I just lost my job, when I got fired because of this situation, right? And then on top of that, that happens, then they want to lock you up, right? Then once they lock you up, you got to get out, and during your lockup sentence or whatever, you're still accruing money that you have to owe in child support. So you're going back and back and back in this payment, right? And then once you get out, now you lost your license, you were in jail, you accrued all this money, you're in the rears, you don't have a job, but they expect you to still pay for it. Then that's when the guys lose their fucking minds, right? And end up wanting to unalive themselves. So if you're doing what you need to do, my thing is, don't put them on child support. Don't be that bitter baby mama and put them on there because you think that you're going to get so much more. I've seen it happen. The person was doing what they were supposed to do. You're bitter. They were paying you X amount of money. You go to court, then the court drops it down. Why? You just fucked yourself. Right?
Not only that as well. In Eddie Winslow's situation, remember, they just had a writer's strike.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe, you know, getting work or getting anything, it was kind of
hard for him.
They was on strike for a little bit. So, you know, the judge or whoever, like, it's, I felt like it was so messed up.
Mm-hmm.
On behalf, like I said, you know, with the writer's strike, and we don't know what his situation is. And I was kind of reading more into it.
Mm-hmm.
Where he was like, you know, he did a couple of gigs for $125 for the day. And I'm like, damn, you know what I mean? And, you know, he's, you know, maybe he's going through it, you know, yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's just, nope, well, I want more money, and this is what it is. So it's just something you have children with,
mm-hmm.
and to know if these people have motives or not, because 9 times out of 10, they do.
Yeah. James said, I was on child support. Her mom was just bitter because he moved on. Even the money you make in jail, child support's taking it. Wow. What's up, Lidana? That is crazy. I've never been in that predicament right there. I've had some scares, right? Switching jobs and shit like that. I've even gotten fired. So I've had scares like that. You know what I mean? But I'm constantly calling them. Motherfucker. What do I owe? You feel me? So, yeah, I've had those scares before. And I've been the one that pulled people over as well that was on child support and saw that they were behind $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, right? It's crazy. What else was I going to say about the child support thing? My other child, my 9-year-old, I put myself on child support for her, due to Georgia being a state where this is probably all states, Where if you're not married with them and you have a child while you're not married, you're not legitimized. So I wanted to legitimize my child, just in case anything were to happen to me, she can bear anything that I wanted her to have. Or you feel what I'm saying? And then also, if anything were to ever happen to her, I could have a say so in, the dealings with her. So I wanted to legitimize myself. And they said, yo, they said, if you put yourself on child support, it'll probably turn out a little bit better in your favor. Yeah, nah, that judge knocked me over the head. He knocked me over the fucking head. But I don't complain. I used to be very, very bitter, especially with my first child's mom, when it came to child support and stuff like that. But now I'm just like, hey, use it for whatever you need to use it for. I don't care. As long as my child is okay, as long as she has a roof over her head, as long as she has food in her belly, that's all I'm worried about.
Taking care of the kids, right?
Ladaina says she always got stuck paying the child support. It's crazy. And you almost had to go to jail because I didn't pay for a year when I lost my job. And see, that's what I'm talking about. And then they expect you to just pull this money out your ass or go to jail. And then once you go to jail, then you're still going in the rears. So what do you do then? That plays with someone's mental a lot. It plays with their mental. And there was a guy on TikTok. He about a year ago, actually, I ran across his live. He was bawling. Well, no, not his live. It was actually just a story. He was crying because his friend was in that predicament right there, where he went to jail. He collected all this back pay for child support. He was in the rears. He got back out, couldn't find employment, couldn't get a license. But they still were nagging him about payments. So he just went off. He went home and unalived himself. It's a mental thing, man. And people just don't understand that.
And I hate stories like that. It's never on that parent side, and it's always, especially the bitter parent, give me, give me, give me, and then that's give me, give me, give me, and that's it. I don't care what you got going on, and oh, they got a new job. Okay, increase. It's a greedy thing. It's an ego, and it's so unfortunate. And I'm glad the father of my kids and I we came to an understanding. You know what I mean? He was on child support because I was on public assistance at the time when our kids were like young, when they were like daycare days, and I was on public assistance, and I had to put them on child support. But out of the child support, I was only getting $50. So it was $25 per kid. But they was taking public assistance. The government was taking most of that. So then we came to an understanding where we just was like, all right, I'll get off public assistance. I got two jobs, and got off welfare. And I didn't want to put him through that because that was a lot of financial burden. We came to that full agreement, and we went to the judge. The judge literally assumed that I wanted to increase it. So you're here to increase it? I'm like, no, we're here to terminate child support. They're, oh, okay, cool. Like they've never heard that, but I'm not, no, we're here to terminate child support. And he went his way, I went mine.
Yeah. Lenina said, yes, because it's what you're capable of making, not what you make. And she said, it's so hard. It's caring about the money and not the child. Yeah, and then also the court system, I believe, just wants their piece of the pie as well.
Lorena should come up.
Lorena, you want to come up, sweetheart? I'll just add her as a guest. Yeah, it's tough.
I sound like sorry.
You sound better. What's up?
No, I feel like it sounds so worse.
Oh, dang. Yeah. No, you sound good. How are you feeling?
It's not a good day. It's
It's
terrible.
gotten worse, huh?
Yeah,
Oh,
but I'm
man.
right. I'll live.
Lelena, Claudine, she was supposed to be here last night, but she fell asleep on us as well, so.
it's all right. That's how I feel today, Claudine. I took some Mucinex PM, and that was it. I was done yesterday.
Everybody's down for the count this weekend, man. Lorena, Claudine, my wife. Man.
Going around.
Yeah. But yeah, Lorena came up here and she's the one that spoke last night. We had a very good topic. Lorena, I need to speak to you offline, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Probably after we get off of here. Or I could just text you.
Okay.
But yeah, what do you think about the whole child support stuff?
Well, I mean, I've always been on the paying end, so kind of, so I get that. Like, usually I hear like all from the men saying, you know, I get stuck paying and I have no money and this and that. But I actually was that person every time, you know, and as you know, I've been divorced. I'm going on my third time now. So I've been through this whole child support kids thing many times. So I think, you know, if it were me, it's, you know, what you make is what you make, and you worked for that, so you shouldn't have to pay the other person because they weren't successful in life, right? Because they didn't do what they could have done to pick themselves up. And some of them, like my first ex, he was born in like a well-to-do family, and he was all about money. Everything was about money for him. So when we separated, at the time he had no job. He was kicked out of the military. He had nothing. And so I was still in, you know, still doing my thing. So I ended up having to pay him $1,008 a month in child support for one child. Yeah. And so it was that way for, I would say we separated when she was two. So for 16 years, I paid him. One of the years is when I got out of the military. I didn't have a job for a year. And I tried to go to court and tell them, listen, I can't pay this $1,008. I'm going to college right now. That's what I'm focusing on. So I can't, you know, I can't work and go to college. And their response to me was, it's not about what you make, it's what you're capable of and what he's capable of. Because he's never held a job. So apparently he's capable of zero while I'm capable of, you know, so much more. So regardless, I still had to pay that 1,008 that I didn't have. And
That is crazy.
so I got for a year, I wasn't able to pay. And then as soon as I got a job, he took me to court and was like, she needs to pay or give me custody. Which if I gave him custody, I was still gonna have to pay anyway. So it was like, and so he fought me. And I ended up having to, I got 10 days in the jail during the weekends that he had our daughter, and I had to do 80 days of community service for like so many counts, and then I still had to pay him 18,000 in arrears.
18,000 in the rears?
In arrears, yeah. And I did. And once I paid him off, it was done. I was done with him. He didn't have anything over my head anymore. And then he lost custody when she turned 14. Something bad happened at his home. And then after that, obviously, I just was paying the arrears, not him, you know, not child support. But I couldn't ask for child support because I owed him still.
Yeah, so if you hold on. If he lost custody, then you were paying that money to who then?
Him, because I was still paying the arrears.
To him? And he didn't
Yeah.
have her?
No.
I can see that somewhat because that was the money that was owed to him
Owed to him before, right.
before, but nah.
Crazy, right?
We're gonna have to
Crazy.
fight. We're gonna have to fight. Judge, we're gonna
What
have
I
to fight on this
will
one.
say is, what I will say is, you know, I always say God works in mysterious ways. Things happen for a reason. You know, he passed away. He was killed in a motorcycle accident. So I was kind of freed of that after a while. So, but still crazy.
Damn.
And then my second one, he went through all that with me, my second husband. So he didn't fight me for anything. No custody, no child support, no nothing. He just said, "Here, I'll let you be." Because he knew I'd been through the ringer the first time. And now my ex now, well, he just don't deserve anything, so he ain't getting nothing from me anyway.
I know my second child, my 9-year-old. Like I said, I put myself on child support for her. Like I said, legitimized her, and I'm thinking that the judge was going to be lenient with me, but he said, "You know what, Mr. Gibbs?" He said $1,300. I said $1,300 for both, right? And I already pay a certain amount for my first child. We were talking about this. I think it was we were talk. No, it was another live. We were talking about the mediators, that come in and or whatever, and write your shit up. Yeah, he looked at me and he said, "Mr. Gibbs, you're gonna have to pay $1,300." I said, "$1,300 for both of my kids, right?" I was almost relieved. He said, "No, that's for the second one." I said,
Oh, dang.
"Yeah, okay, yeah."
Yeah, that's why I, like the title says, the co-parenting thing really has to go the right way because, you gotta be at least on terms of like that open communication and like what, why do you need this? What is it that you need it for? Okay, I'm willing to do this, but I really can't do, that much or whatever. I think if you talk about those things beforehand, it doesn't get to that court level where they decide. Because if they decide, you're whoever or has the most money is going to get screwed, no matter what. It don't matter what, it don't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter, the things that you've given them before. It doesn't matter.
Is it really the person that makes the most money that's going to get screwed? Because if the kid is living with the custodial parents, which is the mother majority of the time, I don't see, her getting screwed. It's the man.
Well, like I said, I had primary custody of my daughter, the one, and I still paid him $1,008. He had maybe every other weekend and like every other holiday. But I had primary. I had all weeks, they were with me through for school every day, and I still got screwed because the time, regardless, the sharing time that he had, he didn't have the same amount of money that I could provide. So it had to be equal in both homes. So it doesn't, sharing time doesn't really matter. If you could have 25% and I could have 75%, but if I still make more than you, that 25% that you have her, I'm gonna have to support you during that 25%.
And I wasn't getting it as well as when I went to go legitimize and I got that crazy ass astronomical number. I was like, where are you pulling this money from? Like, where are you getting this shit from? They go before taxes.
Before taxes,
I was
that's
like,
the
bro,
killer.
I don't fucking mean
Like if I actually made that, fine, whatever, but that's before taxes.
for real. And then I have another one on top of that. Like,
And then you can't even claim that child at the end of the year for those
at
taxes, so
all.
you ain't getting that money
At
back
all.
either.
So, as far as like the co-parenting and letting your differences go to the side, right? Putting your differences aside and having that conversation prior to it getting to that level. I don't know, because like I said, a lot of people are just bitter. You feel what I'm saying? They just wanna they wanna they wanna see you suffer.
Yeah. Unfortunately, all I can tell you, Rich, is you got to be on the winning side of that hand when it comes to
Well, you're
the
not really on the winning side of that. Well, your case is a different case, right? But you have to have, I don't
Well,
know.
that
You're
and
never
that
going to be on
first
that winning
time,
side. You're never going to be
that
on that
first
winning
time
side.
I wasn't on the winning side because I lacked knowledge. I lacked the ability to fight. I was naive in that. I was uneducated. I didn't know freaking my right from my left at that point. And I was more distraught over the way the marriage ended, the first one, than, so trying to take me to court, all I did was cry, like, to be honest, because I was only 21 at the time, and he was abusive, so, like, I was intimidated the moment I walked into court. I had no leg to stand on anytime I went in. Just no fight in me. And his mom was one of the top-ranking family law lawyers in that county. So she basically did his case for free, and I got screwed.
She's a hell of a lawyer. She is one hell of a lawyer.
I mean, she even told him, don't get a job. She bought him an RV, and he was living in an RV on a beach. She said, don't rent a house, don't get a job, she will pay you. And she was right.
James said, wow, he had a cheat code and that was the mom.
Oh, for
That is
sure.
fucking crazy, man.
Wow.
That is crazy.
Yeah, there was no winning that one.
Most definitely. And that's why, that's why men, so a lot of men do the things that they do as far as like, hey, I'm about to, huh?
No, I girl, I'm sorry. It's all
Shit.
right. I'm sorry.
That's done and over with. It's been done for years. She's 22 now, so.
Yep. So
Thank God.
a lot of guys, they try to quit their job or whatever and go work at McDonald's so they could pay the bare minimum, but I don't know.
Nah, but they go off of what you were capable. That's the difference, though. It don't
And what they
matter
don't know is
where you're at now.
they
It's
asked me for like a the last year of my
yes.
earning wages.
Yeah, because they know people will do that. See, he just never had a job. When I was married to him, he didn't even have a job. Like, I was the sole provider. So there was no fighting that. I mean, I couldn't tell him. I couldn't say yes, he. Because he was in the military, he got kicked out. He tried going to college to be an EMT. He failed college 3 times, and then he just didn't work.
Damn.
So, he is just a red flag.
oh man,
Like,
I chose all the winners, Claudine. Don't worry. I was not a good picker. Let's just say
girl, we gotta go out for drinks.
that.
Whew. Bad. I mean, when are we ever good pickers? Like, it's trial d dating is trial and error. I mean, that's a topic for another day, but dating is trial
It's
and error.
definitely a trial and error.
It is, and it's just you just keep trying, and then the error, and then you're like, you know what? I don't want to deal with this anymore. This is not the type of person I want to be with. I know my person's out there. You just not it.
Yeah,
But
but
then
usually you don't
majority of
find
the time is
that in
you don't find that out until years later.
years, and you're already in this
sure, but like I
Commitment.
yeah and sometimes I would just rather just not even deal and just yeah sorry I just had a
No.
yeah
No, I
the
get you.
yeah
That's where I'm at now, that I don't even have time to just, like, I just can't. I don't, any little word or any little sentence that throws me I'm done. I don't even finish the conversation. I'm like, yeah, no.
Yeah.
I'm not doing this one.
Man. Well, I hear these kids about to come down these stairs. So, and I got to get myself ready for tomorrow. I got a long ride tomorrow. But I'm going to bring my stuff with me. And I will be live tomorrow night. If y'all want to join, we can continue this conversation. We can continue the whole co-parenting thing. We could make this like a week-long thing if you want to. But you hear that up there? It's,
Yeah, I can hear him.
yeah,
There's
he's
they are
crying a
wanting that
little.
attention.
And my wife is sleeping because, like I said, she was feeling sick. So this weekend, so I let her rest and they. They're up there with my 14-year-old, and he's probably just fucking with them. I am going to end with this, and we'll go. It says, "We will fail when we fail to try." Let that sink in. We will fail when we fail to try. I will be back on tomorrow night sometime. I don't know when. But once again, Claudean, hey, if y'all are not following Claudean, please give her a follow. She was such a great co-host tonight. I appreciate you for coming on and doing this, tackling this topic with me. I greatly appreciate it. Lorena, I appreciate you. I appreciate you for last night. I appreciate the person that you are. And I appreciate the people that are in the chat. I love all you guys. Y'all take care. Have a blessed night. Love is love, y'all.
Bye.
Bye.